Ladies and gentlemen, now we will start the keynote speech. First, Johei Sasaki, President ICOM Kyoto 2019 Organizing Committee, will introduce the speaker, Mr. Sebastian Salgado. Dr. Sasaki, please.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We are delighted to introduce you to our keynote speaker, the award-winning photographer Sebastian Salgado. We will give you a keynote speech entitled "A Brazilian Amazon Forest Initiative." Mr. Sebastian Salgado is currently working on a photographic project on the theme of Brazilian Amazon rainforest and its inhabitants, indigenous communities, and how they coexist with nature, questioning notions of protection and symbiosis. His work is presented in the form of books and exhibitions in 2021. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Sebastian Salgado.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good morning, my friends. Apologize for two small things. First one, I'm not a normal speaker. I do not write nothing to read to you. And I'm speaking not as a scientific, not as an anthropologist about Amazonia, I will be speaking as a photographer, what I am. And second point, apologize also for my English. That's not a very good English. And, but always, it's a pleasure to be here with you because we are a part of the same tribe. The work that I do, you show my work all over the world, and come here to speak to you about this subject, about Amazonia forest, Brazilian Amazonia forest, is very important this moment. When you invite me, a bit more than 1 year ago, to come here, I made the option to speak about Amazonia. Because I'm working in Amazonia now after 7 years, non-stop. I work much more before, but now, doing a body of work, I'm there after 7 years. In Amazonia, for me, and I believe for all us, for all the planet, is very important, and much more important by the problems that are happening now in Amazonia. Everyone saw this terrible news about the fires going on in Amazonia. And I believe that's very important, our discussion here today, because we're creating a big body of work that you'll be seeing in a few minutes. Some of these pictures, I made a sample of these pictures to show to you. And discuss together the way to present this in the planet, that these pictures become a base of discussion, a base of the debate in the planet, in the way, as the president of ICOM tell yesterday, the way that we can protect the biodiversity in the planet. I believe that's a very emotional moment that we must act together. But before to arrive there, I want to show few aspects of the Amazonia that we can understand better, because you are specialists in your museums, but I go a lot to Amazonia. I have Amazonia inside my heart, and I can speak few points for you. First, I put a map of Brazil in order that we understand what the importance of Amazonia for this country called Brazil. That's the fifth biggest country in the planet. You see, Brazil has a different ecosystem. Amazonia is the big green one that represents about half of Brazil. It's 49.29% of Brazil. And what I put here is not the, what we call in Brazil, the legal Amazonas that's much bigger. This Amazonia that I put here is just the biological Amazonas. It's the ecosystem of forests of Amazonia. And it's about 4,200,000 square kilometers. 4,200,000 square kilometers is 1.5 times bigger than India. India, with 1.3 billion people, is much smaller than this Amazonian space only in Brazil. If you go beyond Brazil, to the French Guiana, to the Suriname, to the Guiana, to Venezuela, to Colombia, to Peru, to Bolivia, Amazonia becomes much bigger. But Brazil has, in portion of Amazonia in Brazil, we have 4.2 million square kilometers. It's very, very big. You understand? It's about 12 times the size of Japan, only this forest. No? And it is amazing, because inside this forest, we have the biggest river of the world. We have 1/3 of all sweet water of the planet. We produce about 25% of the oxygen of all the planet is producing this forest. The importance of this forest for us is so huge, not only because of that, because majority of the distribution of the humidity in the planet comes from this portion of the world. And it is very important for every one of us. I put here inside this Amazon map this point, this space in yellow. These are the Indian territories in Amazonia. They are very, very important spaces. In Brazil, we have an institution that created this space. It's the National Foundation of Indians. It's linked to the Ministry of Interior in Brazil. This foundation was created about 100 years ago by the militaries. The militaries, they care a lot about Amazonia in Brazil. They are part of this new government, but the old militaries that were much more close of the dictatorship that we had in Brazil. But the new, the most young military, the new generals, they are very preoccupied with Amazonia. And they are very preoccupied with the Indian communities. And this National Brazilian Foundation created all these Indian territories protected by law, and represents about 27.6% of Amazonia. This space, by the laws that you have till now, by all Brazilian governments that arrived till now, these territories were protected by law. Now, with the new government, we started to do proposition. The new president of Brazil, extremist and rightist, he want to destabilize these rulers. He want to transform this territory in territory for mining. And you see, this president was elected by two big groups in Brazil. The first group is the that will be linked with the Indians, is the sectors, is the radical religious groups. And the president, the wife of the president, is part of one of these groups. And the president is part of these groups. And for these groups, they wanted to penetrate in the Indian territory to do the Christianization of these Indians. And you see, these spaces represent 418 Indian reservations. Inside this Indian reservation, we have about 310,000 to 350,000 Indians. We have probably a little bit more Indians living in towns, but what Indians live in the forest, we have between 310,000 to 350,000 Indians. We have about 130 languages speaking by the different groups, and we have 169 Indian different groups. It's very important, very sophisticated, and very important, speaking about the Indians, that inside the Brazilian Amazonian forest, we had about 103 groups that were not yet contacted. These Indians never had contact with Western civilization. 27 of these groups, we identified them. The FUNAI, the National Foundation of Indians, send expeditions to delimitate that territory. We know exactly where they are. We never made contact, but we know. And we have 76 groups that we know that they are there because we fly by planes, we see their homes, but we don't know exactly how many they are. But it's sure we have a little bit more than 100 groups that never were contacted. Is very pristine, is very important for all us, because we are living in Amazonia with our prehistory, for the prehistory of the humans. These Indians, they were, when we discovered Brazil, about 500 years ago, we calculate by all the identifications that we can do today in Amazonia, by the anthropologist, by the sociologist, we calculated that there were between 4 million to 5 million Indians. And you have not a genocide, because no one went really kill them, but they were dead by the arrival of the Portuguese in the Brazilian coast. The Portuguese bring a lot of diseases for the American continent that the Indians had no anticorps to resist them. And these diseases start in the coast, and slowly by slowly they advance inside the other Indian groups, more inside the country, and reach finally, after 2, 3, 4 years, hit the Amazonia. And today we have, as I said before, a little bit more than 300,000 Indians. If 500 years ago they were between 4 to 5 million Indians in Amazonia. It's very important, this Indians community. They are in a very dangerous moment, because this government, first, they are taking out the health of these Indians. There is one institution called CESAI. That's government institution, is institution made for the Indian health. They assist every Indian community that was contacted before. And now the government is taking out the Indians' health. And the government is taking out all the financement for the FUNAI, for the National Foundation of Indians, because it's the FUNAI that don't allow the no one penetrating the rivers that bring to these communities. You see, Amazon is too large to fly in planes, to go in helicopters, is by rivers. And the FUNAI put points of control in the entrance of the rivers. It's very easy to do this, and they control. And now the government is take out the financement, and these points have no more money to pay petrol, to pay ammunition, to pay the employment of Indians, of the communities around. They pay small money for the Indians. And is these Indians, with one member of the FUNAI, that guarantee not penetration the rivers in Amazon. The government is taking out, and the Indian territory is starting to be deeply destabilized. I show you another card. These are the units of conservation in Amazon. This is made by all the governments before, by the Ministry of Environment in Brazil, and you have about 30% of the Amazonian space that protect land. Till now, it's protected land. You see, if they made the addition of the strip, 30.5% plus 27.5%, we have about 58% of the Brazilian Amazonia protected by law. If, my friends, we act together, not allow this Brazilian government take out this protection, this space in Amazonas can stay protected. That is very, very, very important. And these units of conservation, you see, in the another cut that we protect, they don't coincide with the Indian territories. Indian territory is one space, units of conservation, a second space. I show now a terrible map. That is what is destroyed in Amazon till now. You see, all these red points is the destruction of Amazon. It's a little bit less than 20%. I put 20% that you see is, but it's about 19.2% of the Amazon is destroyed. And now it's important for us to understand the fires that is going on in Amazonia now. We are not putting fire in every point of Amazonia. No, the fires are happening in the edge of the red, everywhere in the red, the edge of the red. Because do you know, the fires that we are putting now, they start when this president wins the elections. When he wins the election, and he tells to every farmer, to every one in Amazonia, that he will not more protect the Amazonia. My Amazonia must be put down the forest to improve the agro-business. What these guys start to do? They started to put down the forest. The forest, you arrive there, you put fire, don't burn. To burn the forest, we must put the trees down. They must to be at least partially dry to burn. And what they do is a terrible thing. In these farmers that are all around Amazonia, they use big bulldozers. They open ways 5-10 kilometers, one right way, another 100 meters, another 100 meters, and they get guys with chainsaw, the machines to cut the trees. They put a group of these guys cutting the big trees, not put them down. They injure the tree about 80%. The tree is unstable there, but stay hold by 20% of the tree. They go cutting only the big trees for weeks. They cut tens of thousands of big trees. And they come with two huge bulldozers. They point one here, another 100 meters. They take these chains, that you put in the anchors, in the boats. They tie one in the other, and this two dozen goes. In 1 hour, they put down hundreds of hectares, because these chains go breaking the trees that are injured, and one go over the other, they create a dynamic, and these trees go down. And in weeks, they put down tens of thousands of hectares. And what they burning now is exactly this forest that is down. The forest that they burning down is a killed forest. And that is the point. We must act in a way that we need to stop this destruction, this massive destruction. We need this forest. It's the biggest concentration of the biodiversity in our planet. And what's the way that we can protect this? With Lely, my wife, that's the curator of my exhibitions, that designed the books, together we conceived this body of work in Amazonia to put together a group of pictures of the pristine Amazonia, of these Indian communities, of the aerial rivers, of this fabulous forest, in order to bring one quite large exhibit around the planet. And for that, my friends, we need you. We need your music to show the work. We are very close to the Indian institutions in Brazil, to the environmental institutions in Brazil. And we can create a dynamic around the world with these pictures, with these institutions, and we can create a huge conscientization about Amazonia in our planet. And we want in this show bring music. Claudio Santoro, that's one composer, Brazilian classical composer. Heitor Villa-Lobos, they compose incredible music for Amazonia. In Paris, we'll be opening this show in Philharmonia, in the Cité of la Musique. We'll be opening the show in April 2021. Because I just finished the photograph. I'm editing yet my work in order to put all together. I need at least 8 or 9 months to finish the body of work. Lelia needs some time to design the books. I have a publisher that distributes all over the planet, that's Tashen. We'll be preparing the books, we'll be preparing the shows, and we'll be bringing music. We are preparing a lot of projections. In this projection, we'll be bringing Amazonian music. And we want to put in the middle of this exposition, this debate, this discussion. And what I want to do now is a small project, not too small. It's about 150 pictures that I put together to show to you. I put on horizontal pictures. I eliminate all verticals to have a harmony, visual harmony for you here. And I put in this projection music of Heitor Villa-Lobos. I put part of the huge symphony, the Villa-Lobos, the Bachianas. Villa-Lobos is a man that was very linked to the Indian communities, for these rural communities inside the country. And between 1930 and 1945, when he composed this music, he disappeared. He disappeared for 6 months, for 1 year. A lot of people imagine that he died. And he appears. He appears off these sounds, fabulous sounds, that he collected from this forest, from these Indians, from inside Brazil, and he created these fabulous symphonies. And we take part of the symphony, and because we believe that match very well with the pictures. And I invite you now to do a look in this picture, and after I come back to discuss a little bit with you. If you have questions, raise a question, put a question, and we try to discuss. Okay? Thank you very much, and I'm going back.
Good morning. We have some 10 minutes for questions. Mr. Sargado will be glad to answer any questions you might have. Please. There are microphones.
No microphone.
Yeah, there are microphones here.
Sebastian, thank you so much for this extremely touching and moving. First, your talk showing us, demonstrating how the indigenous nations in the Amazon are actually intrinsically connected to the forest, and how they are actually in the front lines of this fight to protect the forest. So here as museum professionals, I guess most of us, or some of us at least, would like to know what we can do to help in that fight.
Apologize, I have bad ears. I just tried my audition in Kuwait War 1991.
Eu posso repetir em português também.
Carlos Luiz, for me in Portuguese.
Ela perguntou como que a gente pode fazer para ajudar a conservar a floresta. Todos nós.
Eu quero saber o que a gente pode fazer como profissionais de museus internacionais. Eu sou uma brasileira que mora fora do Brasil. Então, como a comunidade de museus pode ajudar nessa luta pela proteção da Amazônia? Because this is actually, at the end of the day, the protection of our lives, because it's our planet that is in the line.
You see, Amazônia, we don't know very well Amazônia. We know that is important, but we don't know very well. Same in Brazil, our country. No one knows Amazonia. Amazonia is supposed to be class for primary school, secondary school, university. That is most important things that a country can have is Amazonia. And our country don't know Amazonia. And no one around this planet knows very well Amazonia. I believe these fires that are happening in Amazonia now, they are terrible. They are destroying part of Amazonia, but at the same time, they are bringing a lot of conscience, participation in Amazonia. I believe that the moment now that us together, we must start to open our institutions for people. You guys sit in this room representing thousands of millions around the world. You are representing hundreds of millions of people around the world. I believe, as the president told yesterday in the speech that she did, is the moment that we start to take another position. The architect that explained yesterday the need to open the museums for people. We need to open the museum for people and bring real information for people. And now, Amazonia is this point. People is open to accept, to participate, and what can we do? We can make the pressure in our politicians. We can make the pressure in our enterprises. We can make the pressure in our system of trade, of commerce, around the world in order to do a pressure in this country to protect this space. We have a president in Brazil, democratically elected, is not a dictatorship. We have in Brazil two chambers, one low chamber and one high chamber. Every law must be approved by these groups. And the group, one of the many groups that put Mr. Bolsonaro in power, that the agribusiness, he must take care with their products. And we can, of course, that we not stop to buy the products from Brazil, but we can create a huge pressure in the system of trade around the world in order to protect this. It's not just doing sound, it's not just communicating in internet. We must really act, and act responsibly, in this sense that museum guys, you are the reference of the planet. The architecture will disappear. The industry will disappear. The roads will change. Wait, the museums, never. You represent our history. You represent the history of the humanity. What's inside the museum? Are inside the museums after 300 years, 200 years, and will stay for more 100 years, 200 years. That means the museums are reference. And I believe that we can act together in that direction. I don't know if it's okay.
Thank you.
Time for more questions.
Good morning. My name is Ken Arnold. I work in London and Copenhagen. Thank you so much for a beautiful and moving show. I was very struck that there were no images that hint at the catastrophe that we know is happening now. And I'd just like to hear why you thought you wanted to keep images of destruction out of the show that you gave us.
You see, the destruction, we see the images everywhere, in television, in the newspapers. These are the first images that will come out. But no one knows that Amazonas has incredible mountains. We have more mountains than the Alps in Switzerland. And because no one goes there to photograph this, it's very difficult. We know very few describers. We take a decision to show what is pristine in Amazonas, because these represent 80% of Amazonas. And I believe that we must touch the heart of the people in what is pure, what is important, that we must protect, that we must defend. Because the other images, you see them non-stop, all time. And I don't need me, myself, put months of months to hit a tribe to do fire. I need to spend the time. You see, to work for a tribe like this, sometimes I take 6 months traveling to reach them. You spend with them. I work with about 12 different groups of Indian Amazonians in 7 years. And it's not easy to hit them. And I take a position to show what is pristine, what we must protect. And all the other images, naturally, will be seen then non-stop.
How were the native communities involved in your project? What they think the results, how you shows to them what you produced in your project? Como as comunidades foram envolvidas, as comunidades nativas foram envolvidas no seu projeto? De que forma elas receberam os resultados do seu projeto? Como elas viram as imagens produzidas delas próprias?
You see, to work with the Indian communities is very long, as I said a few minutes ago. We must apply in the National Foundation of the Indian. They must approve what you ask them, that take few time, and they must send someone in the tribe. Apply, put the question, and it's not one person in the tribe that can authorize you to come. The person sent from the Funai must wait sometimes weeks, where the Indians come from hunting, when they are together, they have an assembly, they authorize or don't authorize. And when they authorize, you can come. And what's amazing, that when you come to work with the Indians, the first time that I went, I said, my God, it would be difficult, we don't speak the language, the contact would be not easy. And I tell you, in a few hours, I'm inside. It's fabulous because I'm coming to work in my own communities. These Indians that we call white people, isolated people, they are us. They are just us. By the theories that you have about the evolution of the Homo sapiens, apparently we started 75,000 years ago in East Africa. And we went all over the world. We went towards Europe, towards Australia, towards Asia. And another theory said that about 20,000 years ago, 16,000 years ago, when Bering became a bridge, the Asians walked through and they came inside America. We can believe it because when you see the pictures, we have the impression, a few girls, that they are in Japan. No, they are so Asian people, no, the way that they are. And they came inside America. And when the Portuguese and the Spanish and the British arrived 500 years ago, what happened? They just met the Homo sapiens that walked there before them. If one Portuguese, when he arrived, and you had Portuguese that arrived to have 8 Indian wives, 8-0, 8. And when they have sexual contact, they can have a child because we are biologically, mathematically, exactly the same species. We are the same. When you meet a group of Indians, you are meeting your own community. You come inside your own species. What's important, what's essential for each one of these people? They love like I love. They hate as I hate. They have this sense of solidarity that any one of us have here in Japan, in the United States, everywhere. They have the communitary sense that we have. What is essential for us is essential for them. That means when we arrive there, we meet them. And when we come there to work, we made relations. This house of the Indians become my house. They receive me. And I have a fabulous contact with them. And it's because of this that I said a few minutes ago, that if you open the shows, we can bring the Indians. Because I have contact with the tribes. I have contact with the association, the Indian Association. And every one of these pictures, when I work with the Indian, I send a set of at least 200 pictures in a box for the FUNAI that bring for the FUNAI local that distribute for the Indian. And the relation is very good. These people are amazing people. They are not aggressive at all. You see, the Indians of Upper Xingu, that's a very nice river, that's a big contributor of the Amazonian River. These Indians are about 2,000-3,000 kilometers from the Amazon, but they are in a contributor of the Amazon. They don't eat meat of the animals of hot blood, only animals of cold blood, tortoises, fish, snakes, not to become aggressive, because in the scale of value that they have, the aggressivity is the last one. They are so fantastic, so nice people, that we destroy them with the arrival of the Occidental coal civilization down there. And what we have for our historical reference, we must together add to protect them. That is, as protecting the forest, we must protect the people that's inside the forest.
There's time for just one brief question, please.
Sebastián, gracias por mostrarnos que estamos rompiendo nuestras cadenas, que hemos roto nuestros vínculos con la tierra, que estamos destruyendo lo que somos. Y creo que las imágenes que tú nos has mostrado nos invitan a volver a crear estos vínculos, a sentirnos fuera de las fronteras, a romper los límites que nos quieren imponer los políticos, las economías, los militares, las fuerzas, las religiones, y sentir que somos parte de un solo espacio, de un solo planeta, de un solo universo, y no estamos divididos. Muchas gracias, Sebastián.
Put the question now in English forever. Yeah. Speak in English. Translate what you said.
But I am not very, very fluent in English, but we need to break these frontiers, these borders. We are the same. We are only one. We are in the same planet, in the same universe. And thank you for show us that our real link is our mother Earth.
It's very true what you said. When When I show the map with the red spots on it, you see, this red spot, we don't need it now. In the last 50 years, we destroyed 20% of Amazonia. We destroy together, because it's our society that destroys. It's exactly what you said. No, it's our model of economy. It's our model of life. When I go to the toilet in my hotel in Japan, that we have all this hot water that come, all this electricity, we are destroying the planet. We are consuming the planet. And that finish in Amazonia. That, if, you see, I had no time to speak about. Lely and myself, we have a project in Atlantic Forest in Brazil. Is this, Brazil has two big ecosystems of forest, tropical forest. One is Amazonia we spoke about, but we have Atlantic Forest, Mata Atlântica. Mata Atlântica today is a space twice bigger than France. Is a space four times bigger than Japan. Mata Atlântica is destroyed today 93%. We destroy. We have just 7%. And we just came from Indonesia 2 days ago. Indonesia, I work a lot in Indonesia. We destroy all the forest in West Papua, in Borneo, Sumatra. That is gone, my friends. That is gone to put palm oil in place. And we allowed this. We are eating the chocolate, where at least 20% is palm oil inside. It's for us. It's for us all this. When we went to buy 2 days ago butter in a supermarket here in Tokyo, we put a small plastic bag with ice and gave it to you inside a plastic bag. All this is part of the same destruction that we are doing the planet. Or we take another position, or we come back to our planet. I'm not saying that we come back to live inside the forest, to live in the caves, no. But at least spiritually, we must come back to the planet. The contrary, we do not deserve to live more in this planet. The planet will push us out. We became aliens. The guys that live in Kyoto, that live in Tokyo, that live in Beijing, that live in Rio de Janeiro, we don't live more in our planet. We live in Tokyo, we live in Rio de Janeiro, we live in Kyoto, we don't know our mountains, we don't know our rivers, we don't know our forests. We must go back. And you guys from the museum, you must act hard to aid us to come back to the planet.
Thank you very much, Mr. Salgado. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Salgado. We have a short break. The next program is the plenary session. The museum definition, the backbone of ICOM. If you have used the receiver for simultaneous interpretation, please return it to the staff at the entrance. Thank you very much for your participation. Salgado-sama, ありがとうございました。以上をもちまして、基調講演を終了とさせていただきます。この後、休憩後、プレナリーセッション、ICOM博物館定義の再考を開催します。同時通訳レシーバーを利用された方は会場入り口にてご返却ください。ご参加ありがとうございました。